Once again, good morning and happy Sabbath. I stand here to introduce our speaker, but before I do that, I was told that 35 years ago, a great nation in Africa was born. And we'd like to celebrate God's goodness on that nation. I'd like to ask all the Zimbabwean community to stand. We wish you God's blessings on your Independence Day. Amen. Thank you. As you all know, we are also celebrating a very special day, the Sabbath of God, our Creator. The Sabbath reminds us that we were created by God and redeemed in Christ. It is also our day of freedom. That's why we chose the theme this year, the Sabbath in the African Experience. And we've been blessed by so many presentations so far. Tomorrow we will continue. And we've chosen today to give the opportunity to a friend of Africa. Actually, if you ask all his students, they will unanimously tell you that he is a great teacher. He is a Christ-like teacher. I sit in his classroom even this term, and I can tell you need to be there. Do I get a witness? Those who've been with him in the class. He is a man of experience. If we are not in the church, we will call him a guru. He's here with his beloved wife, another great teacher. We say she's a motherly teacher. I'd like to ask Dr. Prema to stand so we recognize her. Dr. Prema Daipwa. Thank you. So the man that God has chosen to speak to us this morning is none else but Dr. Samuel Gaikwad. He comes from India. He's a professor in the graduate school here. He has two children, two boys, and four grandchildren. Just a short announcement. The two children are doctors, as far as I know, in India. And one of them is a specialist in cancer. Is that right, Dr. Prema? So she told me that anytime I have the opportunity, I can tell the people, if you have someone who is suffering from cancer, their son has a 100% record of healing cancer in India. So just contact them. They can put you in touch with him so he might help you. And I bet you healthcare in India is very, very cheap. People fly from the US to be healed in India. So if you want, just contact them. So without much ado, I'd like to ask Dr. Gaikwad to stand after the special number by the encore sounds.
is tomorrow and is today. Far beyond the human comprehension, the mind can never ever fathom its breath.
Thank you very much for the wonderful song. When we praise God, it's nothing like it. We are His children and we are brought to this world to praise Him. Because that is the purpose for what He created, that we honor Him and glorify His name while we are on this earth. Thank you very much for the song, and thank you for the church family here for inviting me to share a few words with you. But you know, I do not know, because seeing all of you here, pastors, I feel little intimidated here, you know. You are used to preaching and you know how to deliver the messages and all that. I am a teacher. I am not really that kind of pastor that goes out every day, every week and preaches. Looks like maybe it is a conspiracy against me to put me. Oh, thank you. Because, you know, some, I see many of my students up here on the rostrum and here and all that. So I thought maybe to put me in place, they put me up here. Okay. And I hope, I hope the little I have to share with you will be a blessing. And God is the one supposed to speak to us, not I. And so let us listen to what God has to say. Through the little I have to say. We have been talking about Sabbath, you know, for the past few days. And Sabbath is a wonderful blessing for God has given us. And hope I am not going to repeat some of the things that you already have heard. But this is a wonderful message. And I hope at the end of the message, you don't say what this lady said to the pastor. You know, pastor was a young man. He was preaching he had not preached many sermons, but he was doing his best, and he preached in his church a wonderful message of God and his salvation. And while he was talking, he said, you know, God is coming soon and we must be ready to meet him. He is going to take us to heaven. And that was the message, and everybody was thankful to him. And so after the message, everybody was standing at the, while pastor was standing at the door and shaking hands, each one was passing by, and then they were saying, thank you, pastor, and thank you for the message, and pastor said, and some of them were saying, happy Sabbath, pastor, and so on. So this lady came to pastor and said, pastor, happy Sabbath. And pastor said, oh, happy Sabbath to you too. And she said, I'm glad it's over. Oh. And then, you know, again, he was taken aback. Then pastor said, what did you say? She said, pastor, I'm glad it's over. And, oh man, I hope you don't say the same thing to me. It's over. And then when he asked the others, you know, oh, they said, why did she say like this? Oh, they said, her name is Gladys and her surname is Over. So she says, she was introducing herself. I'm glad, Gladys Over. You know. Well, I hope you are not, my name is not Gladys Over, by the way. So, or your name, none of you have that name. Please be kind to me. You know, when we go to shops to purchase, let's say SM, there are those statues there, you know, we call them mannequins. They wear them clothes and they are sitting there, they are standing or sitting and all that. As the season changes, the clothes change. And now it's summertime, and if you go there, you'll find summer attires worn by those mannequins. They're well adorned. And similar kind of clothes are in the shelves there for you to choose from if you go there. But you know, there are certain stores, they don't only have mannequins, but they also have the salespeople, the men and the ladies wear those kind of clothes, exactly the clothes that they have in the shop. And so they wear there and they're selling it. And so when you go and when you look at them, very attractive people wearing those clothes, you say, man, this is the thing I must have. Look how beautiful she looks. Look how handsome he looks. And so you want to buy that shirt or you want to buy that particular pant. That is called, in the business terms, it is called guarding the brand. You guard the brand. You are in the shops, you guard the brand. Guarding the brand is the term that is used when you are exposing yourselves with the kind of items you are selling. And so you make it so attractive so people want to get those brands, get those items, because you are guarding the brand. We as Adventists, we are guarding the brand too. We are called Seventh-day Adventists because we are guarding the brand with two things. One, seventh day, the Sabbath. And secondly, the advent of Jesus Christ. We are waiting for his soon coming. We are waiting. So let us concentrate on the first one. That is, we are guarding the brand of Sabbath. Sabbath is wonderful thing that God has given us. You know, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, and we are so thankful to him. But I would like to say also, secondly, God so loved the world that he gave us Sabbath. He so loved the world that he gave Sabbath, because Sabbath is God's gift to us. It is his gift. He gave it as a gift to us because he loved us so much. Now we are going to see why it is a gift. Why it is God's gift. You know, when you talk about gift, we are so thankful to God for giving Jesus Christ, because Jesus is a gift of God to us. You know, Romans chapter 6 verse 23 tells us that wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. He gave Jesus as a gift to us. But you know, have you ever thought that Jesus, his coming to this earth was his gift to God, his Father? When Jesus accepted to come to this earth to die on our behalf, it was his gift to God. I'd like to look at it that way. That was his gift to God. And then, when Jesus presents us as holy and blameless gift to God, that is Jesus' gift of us to God. And that is Colossians 1:22 tells us that he is going to present us as a gift to God, holy and blameless. That is a wonderful feeling, that I am a sinner, but because Jesus died for me, he made it possible for me to have eternal life. And now, as I confess him, and now as I place myself in his hands, he says, Father, here is Samuel. Blameless and holy, I present you as a part of the kingdom of God. You know, that is a blessing that I cannot forget. I cannot put it aside. He is going to present me as a blameless and holy gift. But then, if you look at Colossians 1:10, that's where the problem is. Are we gift worth the cost? Jesus had to die on our behalf. Are we gift worth the cost? Let us read Colossians chapter 1 verse 10. He says, that I might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. Here Paul is saying that we should walk worthy of the Lord. Are we worthy of the cost that he has paid for us? That is a challenge. You know, if we are worthy, then how are we worthy? Because he puts upon us his robe of righteousness. And that is what makes us worthy. We cannot go with our filthy rags into heaven. Unless we wear the cloak of righteousness of Jesus, we cannot go. And therefore, we have to surrender ourselves to him so that he has an opportunity to place that cloak of righteousness over us. He loved us so much that he gave his life for us. Do we love him? Do we really love him? Okay, great. We children are saying they love him. Yes, we love Jesus, and that we have to show. And at this time, I would like to say, I love him, and I want you to love him also. And that's why we are going to sing one song. We are going to sing a song, We Love Him. And I would like to call my wife, who is this songster. You know, here, if I start singing, maybe I will not have audience after this song. But maybe, okay. So let us have her sing this. But I love this song. It's beautiful about loving Jesus. There you are.
Yes. I think this is a song that we could have sung during our lesson study, right? We were learning about Jesus and the way we love him. Okay. Do you love my Jesus? I love him. 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 Hey, 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 hey. Do you love my Jesus? I love him. 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 Hey, 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 hey. Action. Do you love my Jesus? I love him. 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 Hey, 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 hey. Again. Do you love my Jesus? I love him. 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 Hey, 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 hey. Praise to the Father. Praise to the Son, praise to the Holy Ghost, I'm born again. Praise to the Father, praise to the Son, praise to the Holy Ghost, I'm born again. Do you love my Jesus? I love him, I love him, I love him. I love him, I love him. Hey, 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 hey. One more time. Do you love my Jesus? I love him, I love him, I love him. I love him, I love him. Hey, 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 hey. Praise to the Father, praise to the Son, praise to the Holy Ghost. I'm born again. Praise to the Father, praise to the Son, praise to the Holy Ghost, I'm born again. Do you love my Jesus? I love him, I love him, I love him, I love him, I love him. Hey, 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 hey. Oh, good.
Do you love my Jesus?
I love.
Wonderful, wonderful. Then Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Amen. And that's what God has asked us to do. Keep his commandments. And one of the commandments, the fourth one, is keep the Sabbath day holy. Amen. It is the one that we are talking about today. Keeping the Sabbath day holy. Now that becomes a little problem, you know. We sometimes wonder, okay, how to keep the Sabbath day holy? There was this, you know, after the World War II. After World War II, there was a lot of devastation. So many countries were destroyed. There was a lot of problem. And you know what happened? Many countries were just stepping in and putting up their show and making things happen for the people. And the United States was, still pretty rich country. And they were helping others. And so this particular country wanted certain machinery for their progress. And so United States shipped this huge machinery to that particular country. And there it was there. They were assembling it, putting it together. And while they were doing all that, they encountered a problem. And they said, what shall we do? So this, you know, those days they did not have very good telecommunication or whatever. They used to use the telegraphic code, Morse code, to send messages. And so the Morse code was sent by this country to United States office saying that, please send a man who can fix this machine. We are not able to put it together properly. And so the United States, the company said, okay, we are sending a person there. And so they sent a man there. When the man arrived, those people looked at the person and they were completely disappointed. He was a young fellow. Young fellow, and they said, what is he going to do with this such a huge thing here? And so they sent another message. They said, please send experienced person, experienced and mature person to come and fix this machine. And the message came back from there, use him, he is the best, he invented that machine. When the inventor is there, why are you worried? When the inventor of Sabbath is there, why do you ask others how to keep the Sabbath? We are going to be misled if somebody else is going to tell you how to keep the Sabbath. Because everybody has his own way of interpreting how to keep the Sabbath. The best way to know how to keep the Sabbath is go to the inventor of the Sabbath. Amen. God, Jesus Christ. And when Jesus was on this earth, he told how to keep the Sabbath. He said, I have come not to destroy the law and the prophets. I have come to fulfill. And that fulfillment is the explanation of how to keep his word, how to keep the law. And that's what he came for. You know, keeping the Sabbath is difficult. We find it treasury. We find that it is too much restriction. Don't do this, don't do that. Or what we should do, and we do something, somebody else says that's not right. But you know, keeping God's law is a blessing for us. If I were to say, Psalm 19, and if you could look at the Psalm 19 here, what psalmist has to say, you'll appreciate what God's law can do for us. Psalm 19, verses 7 to 9. It says here, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. You know, this is wonderful. More to be desired are they than gold. What can God's law do for us? It is wonderful, it says. You know, it's perfect. It's wonderful. And it can bring enlightenment. It can bring conversion. It gives us wisdom. It brings rejoicing, purity, more to be desired than gold. And therefore, we must learn to keep the Sabbath. But you know, when somebody says keep the Sabbath, again the problem comes. So many restrictions. Don't do this, don't do that. Why do I keep the Sabbath? But you know, it reminds us of God's creatorship and His preparation of the heavenly place for each one of us. He is doing that for each one of us. You know what happens? We try to find out how to keep the Sabbath day holy. That is what we ask questions. How to keep the Sabbath day holy? One pastor was doing he wanted to take a survey. Now many pastors nowadays are trying to take survey from their, parishioners, the church members. They ask them how they feel about thing, the church, how it is going on, what are some of the problems, what are some of the issues. And so there is a survey. So this pastor was trying to find out about Sabbath, how the people are keeping the Sabbath and all that. So one of the questions was, has anyone ever accused you of breaking the Sabbath? And yes or no? If yes, then the question followed. Why? If no, skip the next question and go ahead. Answer the other question. Nobody accused you. So this man was filling the questionnaire. He saw there. Has anyone accused you of keeping the Sabbath? He said no. But then he anyway answered the next question. He was not supposed to answer. He said, why? He says, because no one caught me breaking the Sabbath. We are afraid of breaking the Sabbath. Why? Because rules made by man about keeping the Sabbath. We must go to God to find out how to keep the Sabbath. You know, I like this strip from Peanut. You know, have you heard Peanut comic strip? This is a comic strip once I read and I just modified a little bit. It says that, you know, this Charlie Brown is talking to his dog, Snoopy. And Charlie Brown says, I heard, Snoopy, that you are writing a book on theology. And the dog says, yes, I am writing a book. And he says, can you give me the gist of that book? What it is? He says, oh, yes, it is about Sabbath keeping. Oh, he says, that is a really difficult subject you have taken. And he says, can you give me that? Have you found an appropriate title for that particular book that you are writing on theology? And Snoopy says, of course, I have a perfect title. And he says, what is it? And Snoopy says, the title is, has it ever occurred to you that you may be wrong? Yes, Sabbath keeping. Has it ever occurred to you that you may be wrong, that you may be keeping the Sabbath the way you think it is right? It should be the God who should be telling you what is right and what is wrong. And therefore, we must go back to Sabbath to find out whether what God is telling, the inventor of a Sabbath, what he is telling about Sabbath keeping. Isaiah 58, 13 and 14 tells us, not about keeping the Sabbath, but making Sabbath a delight. Now, if you make Sabbath a delight, there is no question of keeping the Sabbath. If it is a delight, you will rejoice in it and you will glorify God the best way He has asked you to do. And that is what would be keeping the Sabbath. If you go by keeping the Sabbath, we are going to have problems. Because there are rules and regulations and treasuries and problems, and children don't like it, elders don't like it, everybody has problem with Sabbath keeping. Because everybody is looking for when is the sundown. Sometimes children ask, Has sun set yet? Has it set yet? That means they are waiting for Sabbath to get over so that they can start their playing and games. They are not finding it delightful. But you know, if you look at Isaiah chapter 58 verse 13 and 14, what does it say there? Isaiah chapter 38. Isaiah 58:13-14. It says, if thou turn away by foot from the Sabbath, from doing the pleasure on my holy day. Pleasure means delight. If you go into the New International Version, it talks about Sabbath being a pleasure. If you move away from doing the pleasure, if you move away from delighting on the Sabbath, then you are getting into problem. Let Sabbath be a delight. And that's what we are going to talk about for a few moments now. Why should it be delight? Because we want Sabbath to be a blessing for each one of us and not being some kind of a hard work, something that we don't want to do. We want it to be a delight for each one of us. You know, Jesus wants it to be a delight for each one of us. And that's why he gave examples. He said, you know, you can do wonderful things on Sabbath day. You can heal, you can pray, you can communicate with God, you can do lots of things on Sabbath day. And so, don't look at Sabbath where it says, on this day, thou shalt not do this, that, or the other. There are a lot of things Sabbath, you know, let not this happen, let not that happen. That is true. We must keep those in mind. But to make it delight, those things automatically happen. Let us not concentrate on those things. You know, when God says stop, don't do this, don't do that, stop, he means stop. When you are traveling, you know, when you are, even though you know the destination that you are going to, it is not enough. Because we may not know the best way to get there. We have to stop on the way to get our bearings. Because when you are going through life, there are a lot of traps and temptations. And we may fall through. And therefore, we have to be always ready to do what God is asking us to do. And stop and take the bearings. And that's why Jesus says, stop. Stop and take stock of things. Stop and know what is happening in your life. Because on your journey to the heavenly kingdom, there are traps on the way. Walk with Jesus. Walk in step with him so that you will not slip or you will not get waylaid or get here and there and go astray. We know the destiny, but we should know how to get there the best way possible. And God is the only one who can lead us to go there. So that's why God says, stop, take stock of things and move forward. And Jesus also told many times, stop. Let us see, John 6:43. What does Jesus say about stopping? He says there, John 6:43. Okay, John 6:43. It says here, Jesus therefore answered and said unto them, murmur not among yourselves. Stop murmuring. Jesus told. So no, stop is not something new. When he says, stop doing certain things, stop doing the daily chores on the Sabbath day, the things that you do on 6 days, he is not telling something new. He also tells here, stop murmuring. And then in John chapter 7 verse 27, he has another stop there. John 7:27. He says, howbeit we know this man whence he is, but when Christ cometh, no man knoweth whence he is. That is, here he says, stop judging by mere appearance. Don't judge people by their appearance. Stop judging by mere appearance. And then John 20:27, there is another stop. John 20:27. He says here, then saith he to Thomas, Reach hither thy finger and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless but believing. That means what he's telling him, stop doubting. He's telling, stop doubting, Thomas. Okay, and believe. Stop doubting and believe. And therefore, we need to stop every day to take stock of things, to take bearings where we are, where we are moving. But what is the best time than Sabbath to take stop and take time to think? You know, I think God created Sabbath for a blessing to us. Because I don't know how people go through 7 days work. There are many people in this world who are going through 7 days treasury, doing same work, doing all kinds of things. But you know, God in his wisdom saw that fit to, for us to have that one day, the Sabbath day, to be a blessing for us, which is set aside for us to be a blessing. You know, it should become an oasis for each one of us. Oasis of the week, Sabbath day. Some tourists had gone to Holy Land, and while they were moving around, they came to the hills of Moab. And they were standing on the hills of the Moab, and the guide was with them. And they were looking around, and they saw barren land. And when they looked one side, there was greenery there, one side. But most of it is barren land. And so one of the tourists asked the guide, was it any different during the Bible times, during the children of Israel when they came here? Was it any different? And the guide said, no, it was just the same. There was no difference in that time and now. It is just the same. And then the tourist wanted to ask a little more differently, the same question. And she asked, and she said, "Is when the children of Israel came here, what did they see? I mean, it's a barren land here, a little bit greenery this side. What did they see? They came to the land of milk and honey. What did they see when the children came here?" And the guide said, "They saw the greatest and the largest oasis on this earth. They saw the Sea of Galilee, fresh water. They saw the Jordan River. And they were wandering around for 40 years in the wilderness. This was an oasis for them. They were longing for water, they were longing for proper meal. And here they were now. It was an oasis for them." My dear friends, let Sabbath be an oasis for each one of us. Because whole week we do work. Of course, it will be oasis only if you work for 6 days. If you are not working for 6 days, this cannot be an oasis. It will be another day of rest. Some people have 7 days rest. They say, pastors, no offense to you because you are good pastors, but say pastors, they rest 6 days and work on a 7 day only. But I hope it is not true with our pastors. Okay, they work very well, you know. So let us make Sabbath day oasis for each one of us. And how to make Sabbath an oasis? Now I'm going to present to you something my ears have taught me. You know, don't go by my hair. I am old, but I color my hair, so it looks black. Otherwise, it is kind of white, you know. So the years of experience has taught me a few things, and I want to share with you how we have learned to keep the Sabbath day. And maybe young people who are married or not married also, remember this. It can be a blessing, because yesterday we were reading a morning devotion. My wife and I, we were having morning devotion, and we read a story. And it was told that a company in the United States, the construction company, they were trying to get their people work for the construction. And they found work about 2 hours away in another state where they had to do some big construction. And so all the people who were hired in this state had to travel 2 hours for work and work whole day. And then if they wanted to come back, they had to travel 2 hours back. And so the company authorities thought that is not a very good plan. So they hired some mortals in the place where they were having construction. and so that they could stay there if they wanted to. But they said, we are going to hire some vans. If you want to go back to your home, you could go back. And the next day again take the van that is provided for you and come back for work, but be on time. And can you believe, most of the workers chose to go home rather than staying in the motels. And one of the grouchy worker, he was always grouchy and always finding faults. He never told his family what he was going to do. And so when he said that he has to go and work there and they arrange hotels and all, he went away. But you know, to his family's surprise, his wife and four children, at night he was at home. He came back. And the family was so happy that father was home. And you know, a few days later, the company owner got a letter from the wife saying that, sir, thank you very much for allowing my husband and father of the home to come back home every day. That's a blessing. And because you have done that and you value family so much, we are going to be loyal to you for life. Loyal to company for life. Family unit is very strong. And that unit to remain strong, we must learn to worship together. Because it says, family that prays together stays together. And so we need to have worship together. And so we found certain ways how we can make Sabbath a delight. And let me share with you just a few minutes, okay? And that is preparation for the Sabbath. How do we prepare? Now, you don't have to follow what I am saying. You can have your own way of doing things. But I am sharing with you what we do at home. Preparation for the Sabbath. 1 Corinthians chapter 16 verse 2. Our friend told us about stewardship. And that's where it starts here. Okay. So, 1 Corinthians chapter, what chapter did I say? 16 and verse 2. It says, upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store what God has prospered with. In NIV it says, lay aside money. On the first day of the week, your offering should be ready for the Sabbath. That's what it's telling here. That's how you should be prepared to pay the offering. Not Sabbath day you start searching your pockets and the purse. Is there any change to put in the Sabbath offering bag? We should be prepared on the first day of the week to put the offering, so that we give God what is right and not what is left. Yeah. We have to give God what is right, not what is left. That's what happens when you come to the Sabbath day until Friday or Sabbath, and you are searching for the money to put, and then you see the smallest change possible to put there. We want to give what is right to God. And that is stewardship. Pastor? Yes. Give what is right. And that's what we have done. We have kept aside the money for the offering for a long time, so that we don't have to worry. Plus, don't give God non-negotiable currency. Notes, torn, dirty, nobody wants to take it from you. You go to shop and they say, no, not this one, give another one. So you say, this is the right one for the offering. We should give the best for the Lord. And that's why we must start at the beginning of the week. Keep the best money for the Lord, because He is the provider of all good things to us. He gives us the best. Why are we giving Him the worst things in life? Let us give Him the best. You know, that is what we should be doing. And then, you know, in your homes, my dear friends, we should have worship. Worship, make your home interesting worship place. That children will learn to love the stories. That they will have, you know, you tell them the stories. You should have quiz time. You should have all those things, so that they will want to go to the Sabbath school. You make the Sabbath school lesson so interesting for them during the week that they will say, I'm going to Sabbath school. you know, shall we go to Sabbath school, Sabbath school, Sabbath school, the song. They will want to sing that song at the beginning of the Sabbath, every Sabbath, because they have learned during the week, the Sabbath. And then Sabbath afternoon, you keep everything, your house clean, neat and nice. And you know, we have a tradition in the house. And that is, Sabbath evening, we should welcome the Sabbath. Welcome the Sabbath is very important, because it's very important to guard the edges of the Sabbath. I like what the Indonesians do. Indonesians have a wonderful practice. I was in Indonesia. One of my friends was taking me in a car on the Friday afternoon. And because of the traffic, we could not come home earlier. So we were on the way and the sun was setting. You know what he did? His wife was also with us. He pulled aside the car. We stopped and we sang a song. We recited a few verses and then we had prayer and we started again. Welcoming the Sabbath. And they did. And the same thing he did when we completed, the next day when we were coming back, he stopped again on the roadside and we had worship when the sun was setting. That was ending the Sabbath. They have this tradition and I love that. Because guarding the edges of the Sabbath is a wonderful blessing. We should do that. And so what we do at home is we have worship at the evening. But you know, that Sabbath evening when we have children around the table, our house should smell good. Now that doesn't mean the other days it should not smell nice. Every day the house should smell really nice. But that particular Friday evening, it must smell really nice. The food should smell wonderful. That's why I tell my wife, Friday is the day you should bake bread or make cookies, because the house, whole house is smelling nice because of the bread smell, you know. And so yesterday also she made some bread for, and it smelled so nice. And then to make it special, now our children are not with us, but we make it special for ourselves, both of us. We put, light the candles and put in front of us. Okay. And then we read Bible, we sing song, and then we welcome the Sabbath. And we have our meal together. That's what we do. It is a special thing for us. You may have a special thing your own way. But Sabbath, that's the way we welcome the Sabbath. And then we go to Vespers after that. Okay, that is one way of welcoming the Sabbath. Then on the Sabbath day, we all, you know, I need not tell you what all things to do. You do everything, you know, participate in the Sabbath and welcoming and all that, whatever pastor tells us to do and things like that. Divine service, we should help. And even if you are not a deacon, we should be willing to help welcoming the guests as they are coming in. And but then, you know, I am not going to tell you all the details what you should do on Sabbath. You know. But there is something that you should do and you should not do during the lunch, Sabbath lunch. One thing you should do with your family, which we do also, is that we review the sermon. The pastor's sermon. You know, everybody who gives a sermon, even though you think it is the most boring one, has a message. Because the pastor has come there to give a message. So even if the pastor tells 10 points, at least one of them will stick in your mind if you pay attention. So everybody has a message to give to us. And during the lunch, that is what we should do. We should, you know, revise the message that we get from the pastor. Instead of chewing him at the lunch. He should not become a morsel that you chew on how bad it was. You know. That is not what your children should be hearing. Your children should know that there was a message. And if your children are of age and they can listen, you should tell them, I would like you to see now, this is the theme of this particular sermon that pastor is telling. I would like to you to count how many times he says these words, or how many times he talks about these things, so that, you know, they are listening then. It's a practice for listening. And small ones can be engaged in other ways. In the afternoons, we do things. You know, do not keep yourself so busy that it is not the day of rest. Many times, you know, as a pastor or as a member of the family, we get involved in this, that, and the other thing, so much so that Sabbath day becomes more busiest day of the week. That is, God said, rest. Rest on the Sabbath day. Rest doesn't mean sleeping whole day or sleeping the whole afternoon. Rest means you can sit down, relax, you can read something that you like to read other than your textbooks. You can, you know, there are so many nice materials, Christian materials you can read and have wonderful time. And for afternoon, don't sleep and let your children wander around doing whatever they want. That is the wrong thing to do. Children are not enjoying the Sabbath. They are not finding it delightful. You can arrange with other families, taking turns Sabbath by Sabbath, that several families' children can get together, and that family can arrange something for them in the afternoon. Story time, Bible reading, quizzes, you know, they can act out scenes from the Sabbath by Bible. They will enjoy doing that. Play games. They will enjoy. You know, we did it at Spicer College when we were there. My wife was very much active in that. Our children were small also. We used to have a few families gather together, the children, and then different people get together. You know, she used to be very active in doing all that, arranging for Sabbath afternoon activities and making things happen. You can do for your children. Do not sleep and let your children play outside. I see a lot of children playing to their heart's content as though it's a day holiday. You know, you are responsible as parents to make sure your children are on the right track, and that is important. And then Sabbath evening, give thanks to the Lord, ask blessings for Him, and blessings for the new week that He is showing us, that we can do His will and glorify His name in through our words, our thoughts, and our actions. Make Sabbath an oasis, my dear friends. Make Sabbath an oasis, because that is what is going to be our delight in the Lord. When we delight in the Lord, when we delight in the Sabbath, it is going to be a blessing for each one. Because I love my Jesus. I love Him. Do you love my Jesus? I love Him. Do you love my Jesus? I love Him. You know, that is an important message for all of us. God bless us as we keep the Sabbath day holy.